Hello, hello, and welcome to Catalyst MLM. I'm Brian Switchko, and today on the show, we have Jamie Tardy. Jamie is the creator of Eventual Millionaire, where she interviews millionaires to share their best tips, tactics, and advice from both their successes and their failures. She's been featured on Yahoo, CNN, Fox Business, and more, and has interviewed people the likes of Mike Dillard, Gary Vaynerchuk, Seth Godin, Tim Ferriss, and more. Most importantly of all, without her mentorship, the Catalyst MLM podcast would definitely not look this good. Thanks so much for being on.
Thanks so much for having me, Brian.
So I've known you for a little bit now, and I know your story, so I'm going to kind of dig into it because I think it has a lot of gems of wisdom. And, you know, kind of rewinding back to where you got started, you said in a very early age that you wanted to be a millionaire. You just kind of knew that you were going to work for it, you were going to make it happen. But you got a bit lost in the corporate world. So tell me a little bit more about that.
That's a good way to put it. I just got lost. And then I found my way. Yeah, when I was 8, I wanted to be a millionaire. Because, you know, that's what little girls in Maine like to do. And so it was sort of an interesting setup. So my mom, and I've told this story on some podcasts before, my mom was like, well, then you should marry a rich man. And I was like, Mom, boys are gross. I don't want to. I'm going to do it myself. And so, you know, so it's so funny how that small little piece, but I was very determined and like, I'm going to figure this out. And so, you know, went to college, made great money right outside of college in the corporate world and thinking that's the way it was. My dad told me I didn't have to go to college. And I was like, you're wrong, Dad. Just so you know, nowadays we have to go to college, which is so sad now that I've interviewed so many millionaires. I'm like, no, I don't know if we need to go to college because the debt that it created was ridiculous. Right. So I did get I got a 6-figure job when I was 22, which is huge. Right. Especially for someone so young going, traveling around thinking that I was really cool at the time and realizing that you have no control over what you do. People would call me on Friday and go, and you need to leave today. Even if I had plans over the weekend, I was like, okay, I guess I have to listen to you, which sucks. Nobody wants to have to do that. Traveling when they want, working, I think, up to 36 hours. We were all proud of how many hours in a row we worked. We were like, yes, I'm cool.
Badge,
you know,
of honor.
I know, and we were salary. So really, really, yeah, it was kind of dumb. And so realizing that those things sort of added up, I could only do that for a couple years. And by the end of that sort of stint, I was like, I can't do this anymore. This is ridiculous. Yeah, I'm making great money. And when I traveled more, I made more and I had an expense account and technically everything was awesome. But it wasn't the control, the freedom, any of that stuff. So what I ended up doing was giving up my $1 million goal and going, God, I just want to be able to do something that I want and that I love. I don't care necessarily what my net worth is, which was hard for me to do because that's sort of what drove me for a really long period of time.
Right.
And so giving that up was sort of that piece of going, okay, now how do I do this? Screw the money. How do I find something that I actually like? And that was sort of the switch.
Yeah. And a lot of people have trouble kind of looking outside of that corporate environment. And so, you know, a lot of times it can take, I mean, I talked to someone recently, it took him 15 years before he looked outside of that corporate environment to say, this just isn't really working. So what would be some advice that you would give to someone who, you know, either is getting into that or, you know, in college and looking to get into that, where they're thinking that's how they can achieve their goals?
Yeah. So I think one of the biggest things is now we have so much more. I remember when I was trying to get out of corporate, I was like looking up online and there was definitely stories, but podcasts weren't big. You know, I'm old. So so back in the day when we didn't have podcasts, it was hard to find the inspiration, especially my situation. I was in $70,000 in debt. I was the breadwinner and my husband was a performer. So I was going, I have to pay off 70 grand in debt, which almost everybody that I knew, of course, didn't do that. And so finding the stories online was difficult, just at that much debt. Finding the stories where the wife was the breadwinner and was wanting to quit her job completely. And my husband was he had variable income and all that fun stuff. So it was like, is this even possible to do, let alone that? And so having that was ridiculously hard. So trying to find the stories and the inspiration to find out how I could even do that. And then what would I do to find something I love? Right. So reading tons of books, listening to podcasts now, which we're so lucky to have, on people's stories of talking about how it sucked before and it's much better after, helps you with so much inspiration and just to give you the drive to keep going, because it's a long process and people don't like to admit that. Sometimes they're like, yeah, I want to quit tomorrow. And we all, you know, I wanted to quit tomorrow too. It took me 16 months before I could, but it's totally worth it.
And there's a lot of people that kind of look at that same mentality and they're like, well, you know, that person could do it, but, you know, I could never do it. They think that they're different when, you know, biologically speaking, we are all the same. So what was it that, like, at the root that gave you the idea that you needed to find someone else who had already done it and just, you know, copy them and mimic them?
I needed to know that it was possible, right? And so if I don't see it happening, it's the, there's a great quote, either find a way or make one. Yeah. And I was like, I want to find somebody else that did it. And I couldn't. So I was like, crap, now I have to do it myself. But even I've interviewed over 120 millionaires, right? And when I first started, I remember being like, well, there's something, you know, there must be something different. Like whenever I didn't know any of them, I'm from a small town in Maine, right? Woohoo, there's no millionaires in my town. I used to sort of think, oh, well, they're different somehow. I knew I wanted to get there, but I didn't know exactly what they were like. And so now, knowing them all, I mean, I have so many friends that are millionaires, and it's not that big of a deal. They're just people. Mm-hmm. What a surprise, right? We're all like, they're just people. No way. And just working as hard as they can, trying to make the best decisions they can with what they have, exactly what we're trying to do here. And that's all you can really do. But finding someone else that has done it and can tell you what worked and what didn't work just makes it faster and easier than banging your head against the wall and trying different routes.
Yeah, absolutely. And you get to learn from other people's failures so that you don't have to fail at the same things that they failed at. But so
if we listen to them,
if we listen to them, yes. Yeah. And sometimes that's hard. Sometimes you're like, no, I really want to do it this way. And sometimes you just, I mean, I make it a habit of failing as much as possible because I think it's fun. But so when
you're crazy, Brian. No, I'm kidding.
I know. That's not the first time someone said that. So when you were getting started and you were looking for these people who had already done it, you were looking for the people who were successful, what parlayed that into the creation of Eventual Millionaire, where you now interview them and share their stories just in the, like, you're creating the value that you were once looking for?
Oh, yeah. So I started the blog, actually, the first rendition of the blog, when I was getting out of $70,000 in debt, because I was reading other blogs and stuff like that back in 2005, 2006, which is all, feels like a long time ago. and so blogs were not really that popular. So I had my own blog and I was just blogging about getting out of debt. So it didn't have anything to do with interviewing millionaires, none of that stuff. It was just sort of my personal journey. That got hacked and sucks. I'd written for about a year or so and had a bit of a following. I wasn't really doing it for business. I was doing it just to sort of help people.
Yeah.
And after getting hacked and realizing that my backups were corrupt, because I'm a geek, I had backups. Don't get me wrong. I had backups. They were corrupt. And so I gave that up for a while. And so we paid off the debt. We pushed forward. I ended up meeting a mentor locally who is a local business coach. Amazing guy, sort of took me under his wing so that way he could teach me how to do that stuff too. And so I worked with him for a good 2 years while I was learning how to do it and figuring things out. And I didn't sort of re-bring Eventual Millionaire back until I realized that being a local business coach in Maine, where there's not very many people, a little bit harder than using my skills online, which I already knew how to blog. I already knew how to do a lot of that stuff. I might as well bring that back. And that's what happened probably about 3.5 years ago now.
Yeah, and sometimes it can be really fun to bring old skills back in because, you know, it's a new market and you get to learn new things and, oh, I did this thing a long time ago. I wonder if that still works.
Well, I was also, though, like, why didn't I keep going? You know what I mean? The blogs that I had been reading before that were similar were like this now. And I'm like, okay, that was... Yep. Good job. There's only so much you can do, of course, but...
I had my personal name.com, like switchcode.com, and I knew nothing about SEO, like 5 years later... Went back and it had 34,000 backlinks and I had no idea how. So yes, it's one of those things where you know, you look back and it's like you can connect the dots looking back, but you can't connect them looking forward. And there's no reason to be emotionally upset about that because you can't go back and change it. So
no, we just need to make a machine to predict the future. But besides that, we have to deal with it right now.
Absolutely. And it'll look like a police telephone box. So when you were getting started and you know, relaunched and you launched as Eventual Millionaire and you were, you know, did you immediately jump into the interviews or was that kind of an addition to things?
Yeah, no, I actually started it not with the intention of creating it into being what it is today. Yeah. I went I already have this domain that I really like. I'm going to set up a blog on this, mm-hmm. learn how to blog better, and learn a lot more internet marketing skills and just see what I can do with it. So I sort of went into it. I was also getting a provisional patent at the time, and I was making an iPhone app, and I was doing a whole bunch of other things at the same time. So it was mostly like jumping into something to learn. So I blogged for about 6 months and had probably about 500 readers or something like that. And I was like, well, this kind of sucks. Like, I haven't got... I sold business coaching services through it barely. And I'm like, so it's just a really expensive marketing tactic that isn't really working very well.
Yeah.
I was about to shut it down. I was like, all right, this is kind of ridiculous. I mean, and I didn't really know what I was doing either. So let me just say that. But I was about to shut it down. My mentor that taught me how to do business coaching was like, yeah, send an email to your list. Tell them, you know, you're done and all that. And I couldn't do it. Like, I was like, oh, I feel like I can't do it.
Did he know that was going to happen?
No. Huh. See, so he was sort of like, he knew it was going to take a long time to try and get this going.
Yeah.
That's why we parted ways. So I was working on my own at that point and I brought over my clients from before from him. And so, so I was working on my own, and he was just sort of like, if you're wasting time at it, don't do it.
Yeah.
And a week after I ended up chatting with him, CNN emailed me and was like, we'd love to feature you on the site. And I was like, I'm glad I didn't stop blogging, which is so silly. So they had me on their website, and then they asked me to be on their show, because I was one of like six people, I think, on the stories that they did. Yeah. And then they asked me to be on the show. And then I was actually on the homepage of Yahoo at the end of that week. So this was all 1 week of like, maybe I'm onto something here.
Yeah, absolutely.
So it was insane. And that's what really cemented the fact that I was like, okay, I could probably do something with this. I better get my butt in gear.
Yeah. And there's so many people, you know, that it's the old cliche quote of like, you know, success always happens, you know, right after you're about to give up. And they have, you know, the guy with the pickaxe, and, you know, one guy is like one strike away from the gold mine, and the other guy's further away, but he's like, I'm going to keep going.
Exactly.
And so when you got started and like you had that shift and you said, okay, wow, this is a thing, and you're going to, you know, commit to it and push into it, you know, what was the thing that really scared you the most when you started moving towards the interviews?
Well, the reason why I moved towards the interviews is because I was sick of writing. Like, to tell you the truth, I like writing takes me a lot longer than just talking.
Yeah.
And so I was on my mastermind group, and there were two people in it that already had podcasts, and they were killing it, right? The week before, my friend Maren had sent me a screenshot of her next to like Steve Jobs' podcast or something like that, you know? And I was like, yeah, okay. So I thought, I was like, this will be a much easier way for me to create content. I might as well. And so on that mastermind group, Maren, who is now funded by Tony Hsieh and all this crazy stuff for her business, she ended up going, you should interview millionaires. And I'm like, that's a great idea. I don't know any. Do you? And I asked my mentor, and he didn't know anyone. And I started connecting around here. And a lot of the people locally in Maine didn't want to say they were millionaires, because that's sort of like bad, right? So the first thing was trying to figure out, well, how am I going to get someone to say yes? Like, yes, let me raise my hand, I'm a millionaire, because people were scared of that, especially around here.
Right.
So getting those first few interviews, what I ended up doing was just asking as many people. I had no podcast. I just started asking people. And as soon as someone said yes, which was the first person that I asked, as soon as someone said yes, I was like, shoot, I better get this going. So I scheduled him about a month in advance. And so I could figure out the whole podcasting thing. And it gave me a deadline. And I set it all up. And I was like, I assumed it was going to be like a every other week or maybe even a once a month kind of thing, because I didn't know how hard it would be. But it was way easier than I thought. Like I said, it's been, you know, a weekly podcast, and I've interviewed over 120 now, which is crazy.
And that's awesome. And the kind of more detailed story there was really what inspired me doing, you know, this podcast. And, you know, we've got, you know, a bunch of different content, but same way, not so great at writing. And it was the ripping of the Band-Aid, so to speak. You know, so many people are often afraid of jumping in. And, you know, you're like, okay, I'm going to schedule it out. And in your guide, which I'll attach below, you know, you talk about how, you know, you need to just do it. Schedule it out. Give yourself a deadline. You have to do that. And I had never done that. And then so one day it was the shower epiphany. And I, you know, I was like, I need to do 30 of them like all at once, because then I'll like, you know, I'll never be afraid of them again. And I think you actually called me crazy, even though I was like following you. And, you know, it's that failure and kind of like running directly at it, because when you're afraid of something, if you kind of hit it straight on, what could have really happened if someone said no to you? Or what could have really happened if the podcast didn't go so well? And I think you have a story about that for your first episode, right?
Oh, it sucked. Oh, it was horrible. I like, for you, I recommended, you know, practice would be a good idea before you interview someone in person, because I didn't do that. Be a good idea. So yeah, I hate my first interview is ridiculously bad. I think it's still on the site, and I tried to tell people not to go, and of course that's why they go, which is horrible. But I didn't know what I was doing whatsoever, and that's not something I recommend. But I think it's really important to know is that after a certain amount, you just get better, and there's no way that you can practice 1,000 times beforehand. You just have to do it, you know, and really get out there and be like, oh, I screwed that one up, you know, and going back and listening to what you did, even though it's really painful.
Yeah,
and not fun. Definitely worth it, and you totally get better. Like now, people are almost everyone, and I'm really lucky to say this. Almost every single one of the interviews that I've been doing, at least one person says this is the best interview I've ever heard. And I'm like, by amazing people. They said that about the Seth Godin interview. Of all of Seth's interviews, I got a bunch of people saying that it was the best. And I'm going like, wow, that means something. That's huge. I was really bad before. And don't get me wrong, it's Seth's wisdom that works very
right,
well.
Right.
But, you know, I played a little piece, so.
Well, and you did a speaking where you taught people, you know, how to run a podcast if that's something they want to do. Mm-hmm. And you talk about, you know, kind of just getting better and getting better. And so you're standing on stage and talking, saying something like that. You know, Seth Godin said, I'm, you know, the best interviewer, and the people in the crowd might be thinking, well, you know, that's just Jamie, she's amazing, you know, I could never be Jamie. But the reality of it is that you can actually watch your first episode and it's not what your episodes now are. And so, you know, kind of just driving home the point that, you know, you're gonna suck when you get started, but if you keep going, you're gonna get better. And the person who just, you know, in any capacity just keeps putting one step in front of the other, they're gonna be far and above everybody else who gave up.
I get asked all the time, like, how do I get Seth Godin? I'm starting this new podcast. And I'm like, don't interview Seth Godin yet. He's a hard interview, right? Yep. He's been interviewed 1,000 times. And so I wouldn't start with that. Like, your first month, I'm impressed, Brian, that you're doing so many crazy ones, but you're going to be so amazingly better. I'm sure looking at your first one to your last one, so much better. And now you can be like, okay, I can handle whatever. It's not a big deal. And so I'd highly recommend getting your skills a little bit better before you end up getting someone, you know, high end, because you do want to make sure you do a good job. But yeah, totally.
And on the same note, I mean, you know, podcasting is one piece of it. And, you know, you also do business coaching, and with both business coaching and your website, you know, there is an element of sales. You have to sell your expertise.
Mm-hmm.
And you talk a little bit, I was trying to find it in the interview because I wanted to post it, but there was one where you talked a good bit about it, about your experience with selling Kirby vacuums.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a lot of people who have gotten there. So what did you learn in Kirby that really helped you to, you know, keep going and land your first interview and land your first coaching client?
That's a good question. So number one, Kirby was a horrible experience. I mean, I was 17 when I started working there, and they taught some kind of shady sales tactics, right? Like pushy sales tactics. So me going out, like cleaning people's carpets and going like, hey, I wouldn't push sales. Like, I felt like the worst, lowest person ever. And so that actually set me up for a really crappy way of looking at sales. So I was like, I never want to be a used car salesman. I'm not getting into that, which is why I think one of the reasons too why I pushed so hard going into corporate, because I was like, I'm not doing that. That sucks. Yeah. So the interesting thing is, though, my mentor taught me a whole different way to do ethical selling, mm-hmm. which I didn't know existed at the time, right? Like, you can have a win-win situation? No way. I thought you were trying to screw people out of their money. Yeah. So I think that's really what helped. So it was the mindset of Kirby, in that selling, you know, is important, right? It was all about sales. Everything is about sales. And then the other side of it, and going, yeah, it's about sales, but you can do it in a good way. And it's more about how many prospects and how many qualified prospects you talk to and how you talk to them, because the way you say it really matters. And so when I'm asking people to do interviews, I mean, I don't know if I gave it to you, but I have like a little structure where I'm like, okay, first line, you know, we tell them why you like them or that you've been listening to them, you know, be honest, of course.
Actually, the second one is on my desk right
good
now.
See, yeah. Credibility, you know what I mean? So it's very similar to a sales tactic, but you're just trying to establish rapport in a cold email, which is a little bit harder, but in general, that'll help you get more people to say yes to you if you can do it right.
Yeah. And a lot of times, I mean, if anyone goes through their email box and they look at, you know, go find the first spam message, you know, the first line is trying to sell something, trying to get you to purchase something. There's no relationship. And the template that you're talking about, which I'll link below, it's really just you kind of build a relationship on, like you said, a cold email. And the same thing goes for, you know, an email, if you meet someone at a party, whatever it may be, you know, and you're networking with millionaires, but it also goes for, you know, selling a product in multi-level marketing or whatever it may be, is having that, you know, tiny sliver of a relationship to let someone know that you know what they want and you're here to provide it, not I'm trying to get you to buy this thing just for the sake of buying my
exactly product. Like I'm gonna leave in 10 seconds after you say yes, you know what I mean? And I think that's what and with multi-level marketing or anything just in general, it's, I mean, you call it relationship marketing for a reason. And so it's all about, to me, for my sales, for anything, I want to be friends with them first, right? Like I want to be able to call them up and be like, hey, you want to help me move? No. but be able to have a good relationship where you can help them, they can help you. That just expands your network more. I mean, I think networking just in general builds businesses, whether you're in multi-level marketing or not. And so being able to build that rapport and build that network is huge. But you'd be surprised how quickly you can do that too. I just got an email. I interviewed David Allen from Getting Things Done, and someone emailed me and was like, oh my God, I can't believe you got him. And I was like, that was a cold email. I didn't know him at all. Yep. You know, one quick cold email, done. That's awesome.
And sometimes it works, and sometimes, because you have a story about Barbara Corcoran.
Yes.
And you couldn't
thanks
get her.
Thanks for bringing that up, Brian.
Well, I mean, it's flip of the other side of the coin.
Oh, I know. So my client, who has a podcast called Entrepreneur on Fire, John Dumas, love him. He and I both asked Barbara Corcoran. Now, mind you, I taught him how to get really awesome people. He one-upped me. So, you know, the student surpasses the teacher. So he one-upped me. And when he, and I don't know if you have those links, but you can post those too. Yeah. I actually have the actual email that he got Barbara Corcoran to say yes. And so I tried the woman entrepreneur angle. I was doing that angle. He went the, you know, I was in the military angle. Yep. Military angle won out. So yeah, but it was a cold email too, which he got, which I'm very, very impressed with him. He's really good at that.
But it's a great example of like, you're not always going to get a yes.
No.
And that's okay. And you know, you're not always going to get a yes, but when you do get a yes and you work with it to create a relationship. So between your coaching clients and the people that you've interviewed and kind of everything surrounding that, I know that you've made some really amazing friends. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, forget business contacts, you know, friends. So tell me a little bit more about how, you know, networking with people and asking them to be on the interview. And then, you know, I know that you provide value to a lot of people where you just help and, you know, what can I do to help? And then you build that relationship. How has that provided value to them and then eventually come back to you?
So a couple of different things. I don't want to call them tactics because it makes them sound kind of sleazy, but this is what I usually do to try and build the rapport, because I try and build a deep relationship. Like I love acquaintances, but that's not really what I'm looking for. I'm looking for deeper relationships with people just in general. Mm-hmm. Because we can help each other out, which is awesome. And so I love to try and connect with people on something that's not work, usually. So like going to a conference, we'll talk about music, we'll talk about, you know, a whole bunch of geeky stuff. I met Joss Whedon at the last conference, and I went to everybody going, do you know
so
who Joss Whedon is?
So jealous of that picture.
And the people that didn't, I was like, okay, good to know. Move on to the next person.
You
know,
you are not a nerd.
I know. So, and that is something. And so the guy that I ended up, one of the guys that I ended up meeting was like, oh my gosh. And he, you know, helped promote Dan Ariely's books, Daniel Pink's books. And I'm like, I have a book coming out. We should chat. Yep. And so, I mean, and he's great. He's got a great book. His name's Tim Grawl, called Your First 1,000 Copies, which is a great book too. But it's so funny because I was like, that's how I found, you know what I mean? That's how we connected. Like, you're a geek, I'm a geek, this works really well. Or even on the podcast in general, it's a little harder to create that rapport when you're not in person. It's great to be on video. I think I highly recommend video just so I know what you look like, right? If we didn't know each other at all, it's sort of like, yeah, I passed you on the street, I wouldn't know.
Right.
And so I think video is helpful for just building the relationship that way. But I'll definitely, like, I have 3 more millionaire interviews coming up later today. And I usually do a beginning of, like, just getting to know them a little bit and chatting and joking around, like, trying to find out something that we can connect with, right. And be really down to earth, not like, welcome, today is the show and we're going to be talking about, you know what I mean? Just like, hey, how's it going? you know, not a big deal at all. And then towards the end, if I can help them with anything, I totally will. If I can refer them to somebody, I will. I try and find out if they're going to any conferences so I can meet them in person. Yep. Just try and do some sort of follow-up with them, especially if I feel like it's somebody that could be really, really useful in my network, right. Not even for me, but for anybody else I know. So being able to just do another connection and then keep in touch with them, right? So I try to go back through and email people, or if I'm going to be in their city, I try and meet up with them or something like that, just to build the relationship a little bit deeper.
Yeah, yeah. And it's interesting because a lot of times it's a lot of the people that you interview, they all know each other in some way, shape, or form. And once you kind of like get in and you get introduced to one person and then another, and actually I went to interview Hal Elrod earlier, and as I'm going to do it, before the camera could turn on, I hear, "Hey Brian, it's Peter Voog," and I'm like, "Peter Voog, wait, what?" And it was one of the guys that I was interviewing like 3 days later in his office, and I'm like, "How?" But they live like states away. And
well, and yeah, I know, and Hal sent me his book, and I know Peter because Peter connected with me a long time ago, which is so
silly.
We
made that connection,
you know.
Yeah. And
like, you had him on the show. I'm like, "I know Peter."
And so like everybody really is connected in some way, shape, or form. And it's all about, you know, relating to people. And, you know, I was talking about building a mastermind with someone earlier, and, you know, we were looking like skill set doesn't matter. What matters is a similar mindset. And it could be a similar mindset on nerdy geekiness, or it could be fishing. It doesn't matter what that is if you build that relationship. So when you built those relationships and you started to offer that value and make those connections where possible, but, you know, did you do that with the end in mind in terms of getting something back, or did you do it because you knew in some roundabout way you would benefit from it eventually? And then what did that look like?
Eventually. Yeah. Yeah, no, I'm all about, so I read The Go-Giver by Bob Berg. I interviewed Bob Berg. Love him. I don't know if you have read the book before, but it's really quick, easy read, and it's all about giving. And I read that when I very first got started in business, and I've been going by that mindset the whole way. I'm a giver anyway. I love helping people. That's sort of the whole point. And so, yeah, maybe later they can help me. That's totally cool. But I don't, it's harder for me to ask than it is to give. So personally, I just like to give, and whether or not it comes back, I mean, at all, so far, not every relationship comes back 50-50, whatever. But in general, if I need anything, I have people I can go to and ask. You know, I was chatting with someone yesterday. I'm like, "Oh man, my sales page for this sucks." And he's like, "Do you want me to look at it?" And I'm like, "You're amazing at it." "Yes, I do." You know, and it's so silly how that works out. But those silly little things really make a big difference.
Yeah, they absolutely do. And millionaires need help too.
Who knew, right?
Who knew? So if you're, you know, giving advice to someone who's looking for someone who they can, you know, someone who's successful and they want to model their success, and, mm-hmm. you know, let's say rewind all the way back, they're stuck in corporate, or they're headed to be stuck, being stuck in corporate, and they need to find someone who's done what they are looking to do, or mm-hmm. they need to find out what it is. What is that first step that, you know, you took back then that could be equated to something that would be more appropriate to do now?
Okay, so I'll give you two. So the first one, how I found my my first mentor, he was going to be my competition. And I was like, I should probably meet him. He was like 60 years old, you know, sold $1 million business. And I'm like this 25-year-old girl, like coming and going, like, "Yeah, no." So that was kind of insane. But being able to build the relationship with him was huge. We ended up chatting for over 2 hours. I sent him a thank you card. And he was like, wow. He was looking for a business partner, but he was looking for someone who was like 45. Right. Not 25. But he ended up chatting with me and going, "Okay, I really think you have something here," and was really impressed. And so that's how we started working together that way. I said, "I'll work for you for free as long as I can just come in and see exactly what you do." Right. So I worked for, you know, 5 or 6 months for free for him. And I helped him with his tech because he wasn't so great with that. And he helped me learn so much. It's ridiculous. Now, I was lucky enough to be able to have that piece. Mm-hmm. But the second time, so when I went online, besides building my mastermind group with some amazing people, I did that too. But I was like, I need
most
some one-on-one
help.
Most of
whom are in our podcast.
I know, right? So I think one of the things that was important then is I wanted someone. I built this mastermind group, and I was like, I'm not really great at this. I don't. They're really good. I don't really want to ask them like this silly questions because I didn't want to feel dumb. Yeah. So I ended up finding another mentor that would just help me online. And he went out on Twitter one day and was looking for a project manager. I used to be a project manager. Yeah. I was like, you know what? I'll help you for 5 hours a week for free if you can teach me how to do this stuff. And he was like, sure. And so I ended up actually becoming his business coach. But it was really interesting to sort of go, yeah, he's like, of course I would. I mean, you're going to do this for free for me. And all I have to do is like tell you, spend an hour with you and tell you exactly what to do. Yeah. Totally cool. So we did that for a good 3 to 6 months. And that was really, really helpful because he already knew what to do. And he just told me like it was like, no, you should do this. You should do this. Don't do that. And he also helped me meet so many people in the industry because he also had sort of a name and spoke at a bunch of conferences. Yeah. So when we went to a conference together, he invited me to and introduced me to a whole bunch of people. So that's sort of how things go. It's not as though I look for opportunities all the time. It's not as though you go up to someone, you're like, hey, will you be my mentor, please? Yeah, yeah. I'm really cool. You need to really show them and give first, just like we were saying before.
Yeah. And I mean, those are two stories that kind of tie back to immersion. And just, I mean, be it following them on Twitter, podcast, leaving comments on the blog, you know, reading everything and just engaging. You know, eventually it gets more and more personal and, you know, you end up meeting up with people that you followed on Twitter for 2 years. But, you know, a lot of people, and I, you know, have to address the skepticism, a lot of people might be like, oh, I don't have time for that. But what can you address that piece of it? Because you obviously went from working insane hours in corporate to now where you are. And, you know, you learned it. You immersed yourself and you learned it. So how would you recommend someone else who had that objection to their own capabilities? How would you recommend they go about it?
That's like one of the most common excuses ever, right? And don't get me wrong, like time is a hard thing, but I love the quote that says time is a created thing, right? To say that you don't have time means that you don't want to, by Lao Tzu. Love that quote. Use it all the time, right? So it's all about priorities, of course. So I'm not going to give you a whole productivity or figuring out your priorities thing. I think if you want it badly enough, you'll figure it out, right? The couch looks really good to sit on when you're exhausted after working all day. but if you can put in a short amount of time, like when I was paying off debt, I was pregnant. I was very pregnant, like 7 months pregnant, working like 70 hours a week going, wow, this is horrible. And this sucks really bad. But I know later it will be worth it. Right. So being able to do a short period of time as hard as you can, like you're doing 30 interviews in 30 days, like immerse yourself as much as humanly possible for a short time period and see how it goes. A lot of the times it can be really motivating and help you move forward. And so I would try and do something more like that because we think, oh my gosh, how long is this going to take? This is going to be forever. It doesn't have to be that way at all. You can just set up short term goals and then take a week off and relax and don't let it be that big of a deal. But time is one of the biggest excuses that stop everyone. No matter how slow you're moving, as long as you're moving forward, one of the main things that the millionaires come up over and over and over again is continuous forward motion. Continuous forward motion, no matter how small, you know, if you're talking to one person every day, that adds up. It'll take you longer, right? When I first started in business, I was working 20 hours a week because I had small children. Two small children running around makes it very difficult to do anything, let me just say. And so I felt like it was going to take me forever. But now, like, I work probably about 30 hours a week now, but I have a team of 4 other people that, you know, times it by this many. And so it took me a long time to get that. But it definitely, as long as you keep moving forward, set up little short-term goals so it doesn't seem so overwhelming, that usually helps.
Yeah, and I've seen it in a lot of your interviews talking about failing forward. And just, you know, like if you fall, as long as you fall on your face, you're good.
Good. It's wonderful. Yep. I mean, I did so many stupid things and I was like, that was a waste of time, but it really wasn't in the long run. And so you think that it is and you'll look back later. So have your older self just be like, hey, keep going.
That's awesome. Thank you so much. And I'll have links below to the podcast, the template that you talked about and all the books. And I will definitely have a link below to Eventual Millionaire, where there are 120 wonderful interviews with some awesome people that so far have not said yes to me. So far.
I know, exactly. Gary Vaynerchuk says do it at least 3 times.
Peter Voog and Gary Vaynerchuk are like BFFs now because of a similar story.
Different
story. Yeah. He asked. He asked. That's all it was. And it was the same thing. So yeah, I mean, it's great advice. It's a perfect mindset. And I definitely know it's going to help a lot of people listening.
Awesome. Thanks so much for having me on, Brian.